Right, exactly. And we've had this for in different forms since well before television. In the early days of radio, there were ham radio operators. They had crystal sets, and they would do things. My son plays the violin. They'd put their son on. They'd read election results and have a great history of always getting them wrong on the presidential election, announcing the loser as the winner, which we've seemed to have followed up in modern
But
television.
now the person who's reading this book in your class says, "Well, I think I could be Steven Spielberg." The first thing you say to them is, "Write it down. You've got an idea, put it on paper."
Absolutely. Everything, it's a cliche, but it's true. Everything starts with the script. If it's not on the page, it's not on the stage, and all of those limericks.
And at that point, you have to know what is a character, what is a scene, and what are you trying to say?
Exactly. And I think, even if it's just a standalone short video that you'd make of your friends singing or something, that's not what this book is about. This is about a series that has consistent premise, tone, characters, and tell stories about those things week to week, or not week to week any longer, episode to episode.
And how much should you sort of plan to spend?
Well, it can be anything from the change in your pockets to millions, and there have been examples of this. The truly deep pocket players like Sony fund the big budget things. Other people really just make it on their own personal budget of couple $100. The guys who made the TV show It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia shot the pilot themselves for $75, the cost of the videotape.
Well, we're seeing commercials now where the woman turns around and said, "And they shot this commercial on this little camera."
Well, again, the manufacturers have tapped into the incredible creativity that's out there because young people are so video savvy. They have contests now. Make a commercial for our phone company, make a commercial for this for Coca-Cola, and you'll win a $10,000 prize. I gotta imagine there's some ad agencies who are a little bent about
Yeah, I
that.
would think so. Because what it's doing is not maybe lowest common denominator, but it is lowest common financial denominator that, hey, you won't do it for this price. Somebody else will.
There is going to be some pressure on the markets that way. I don't think it's going to eliminate the big players there because you can't, on a little budget, do the same kind of work you can do to make something that's technologically sophisticated, like 24 or Lost or something with huge production value. Those are going to cost a lot of money no matter whether you put them on the internet or put them on broadcast television.
Other, be sure you have your permits. Or be
Yes.
sure you have, like I said to you, will you sign this release?
Right. Right. We have this conversation with our students all the time. The world is not your sound stage. You don't get to go march all over it and just whip out a camera and shoot. You need to get permission to go on public property. If you're in your own bedroom, film away. But you can't go to the train station and start filming.
And the same way you need to know what lights you're going to need. And what are you doing? Can you use the sound in the mic in your camera, or do I need to get a boom?
I think it depends what you want it to sound like. If you want it to have a cinema verite or newsreel kind of quality that sounds like it was filmed on an amateur basis and with handheld camera maybe, then I think using the mic in the camera is absolutely appropriate because it's going to give you the sound you want. If you want it to seem like a filmed, staged product that doesn't remind the audience of the filmmaker, then you're going to need a boom.
And what about lights?
Lights, again, you can get a perfectly acceptable exposure for a room in the daytime or certainly outdoors in the daytime without lights. If you're going to film at night, you're probably going to need outdoors or in a dark room, or you want a particular effect. You're making a horror-based series. You'll need lights.
We're talking about digital cameras, though,
Correct.
so that there really isn't tape there. You're taking the picture that the digital does, putting it onto your computer.
Yeah, they are different recording devices. Some of them are just like in your still camera that you take on vacation, a card that you put in, that then you upload that information into your computer. But it's incredible how accessible this equipment has become, that equipment that you use in your daily life just to take pictures of your family and friends is adequate now to make a certain level of this. It's not going to get you high definition, ultra high quality, but good enough in many cases.
But you said that in the book, that it's not necessary to have a high definition camera or anything. Start with what you do so that you may not even know how to use a high definition camera.
Right, and I feel that the audience has become acclimatized to not expecting high production value. If you turn on CBS and you see the camera's not really very good and the image is fuzzy, you'll be bothered. But when you go to YouTube, you care more about the content than the production value.
By the way, I should tell our friends in the audience, at the end of every chapter, there's advice to teachers, so that this book is a teaching tool as well as for somebody who's a little bit older who's not at school.
Yes, well, I really wrote the book for two audiences, one being the general public as a how-to for people who want to make web series, but also for teachers at many levels, college certainly where I teach, but high school and even junior high, where kids are so media savvy that they have the technology to make these films.
And usually at those high schools, they've got terrific equipment.
They can, because it's so much less expensive than it was in the past. In 30 years ago, students went to, at the university level, film school because they had the equipment, and no high school had expensive equipment. Now it's so inexpensive that a high school or junior high school can afford digital cameras, and they can edit on the computers they already have. The thing you bought to just conduct your life and write emails on has editing software on it.
The other thing, though, is just because it's like writing a book, just because it looks like a page on your screen, it ain't a page if you don't know what you're doing. And that's what you're doing here. How to break down a script. How to put in what shots are you going to use? How can you use that set for a scene that's going to be 2 days later?
Yeah, my background before I was a college professor was a television writer. I'm a writer by trade, and I'm firmly of the belief that that is 90% of the task here, and that you can find other books that'll tell you how to work the camera or how to edit, but so much of what there isn't enough instruction on is how to build the architecture of a television series.
We should say you wrote Facts of Life, Who's the Boss, and I'm sure a myriad of others.
Yeah, I worked on The Cosby Show and Step by Step and a bunch of other family comedies.
How did you get into writing?
Well, I went to journalism school actually when I was in college at UC Berkeley, and I was sort of torn between the writing world and the film world. I had gotten very lucky and worked as a production assistant for companies that made TV commercials. One of my first jobs was standing in for a dog because I was cheaper than hiring a second dog. And so I was on my hands and they didn't want to tire out the star dog.
Yeah.
So I was on my hands and knees in front of the dog bowl.
You have got to put that in something.
Yes,
that's the funniest thing I've heard.